instead of working all day in the clinic, I would make little trips to Shenge, to another thing. And when I was up in Jayama, I went on trips way off the Kono country, Sasayama, Chidobe, etc. Little thing, just to talk to the people and tell them that these things for which we are treating you now, if you did certain things like sleep under a mosquito net, take anti-malaria, you will not be sick with malaria every time. If you drink water that is boiled, your children will not have this dysentery. And that was my public health message. But you see, as I continued to do this, when I returned to Rotifung, somebody had met when Rina and I came to attend a conference here in Washington, the World Malaria Conference. And at that conference, on our way to Africa, we met a man who later became the first principal of the University College of Ibadan. We just met him casually. I was a graduate of medical school and I'd done my public health degree. So he took an interest in me. So when he was appointed principal of Ibadan Medical School, which was the first British medical school in all of West Africa, in fact, all of Africa, the first one, he heard I was now at Rotifung. And he wrote to me and he said, look, Dr. Karefa-Smart, remember we met at Washington, D.C., and you have a degree in public health, etc. How would you like to come and teach in a medical school in Nigeria? So here I was doing work with the people at Rotifung, and I was tempted. But then we had begun to have troubles which have been with us all the time. The missionaries who did not like my switching from doing the work for which they thought I was trained and was doing this public health work started to say I was troublesome. Ah. Why would I want to do some of this? But what was more than that, with Rina, a theologian who had got a degree from Yale and from the big school, I'll tell you later on, and trained, her father was a pastor, like my father was a pastor, and we took a different view about what the missionaries were doing. We said, look, you've come here, we thank you very much, you've shared with us what we believe in, we accept the Christian gospel, but how is it that you're always in charge? My father has been a minister in the church from before many of you missionaries were even in high school, but yet he just remains an African pastor. You are all in charge of everything. And my wife and I said, you know, we should do what other churches are doing around the world. In India, they're forming a national church of India. In other parts, and people of India are running their own church. Instead of being a mission, we want to become a church. And they said, here you are, you've got to cause trouble anymore. But we still talked to that. And then they did another thing, which was in a way insulting, but I hope you don't make too much of it. They told me that although I was a physician, I had an MD, and I was a doctor in charge, yet I had to take my orders from the lady nurse, who incidentally, she was older than me. She was there when I was born, but she was only a nurse. But they said I was only medically in charge, but she was in charge of the work we were doing. And everything I did, I had to have a permission. And of course, when I was doing it by myself, I didn't mind, but with Rina there, and coming from from the United States, you see that. So those two things. So those two things together, without getting a little bit more not treated right by the missionary people, and an invitation to go and do something, and the winning argument was this man whose name was Mellanby, Kenneth Mellanby, said, look, let me tell you something. As a teacher, you'll be able to duplicate yourself. If you remain doing what you're doing now, when you die, there'll be nobody to continue. So why don't you come and teach and duplicate yourself? And that was a winning argument for me. So Rina and I said goodbye to the thing and we went to Nigeria and became there. It was from there that Dr. Magai invited me back. And let me tell you why he invited me back. On my way back, not from Harvard, but from medical school, the Episcopal group here, they call them Episcopal here, not Anglican, heard I was going back and they said, you're going back to Africa? I said, yes. They said, but look, where did you study in this country? I said, I studied for 2 years in Ohio in a white school. And they said, you cannot go back to Africa. And the people ask you, how about the black people in America? And you know nothing about them. So we'll give you a travel scholarship. At least you can go back and say, yes, I did. I did meet them and I traveled and I did. So they gave me a travel scholarship and I was to go to first Hampton, which was just down the coast, and then from Hampton to Tuskegee and then from Tuskegee to Mahari. And I went and I met them. But the very first place I stopped in Virginia, just across the river from here, actually a little further down, there was one of these land grant colleges, a black land grant college. And the principal of it said, oh, you're going back to Africa. Well, I think, you know, there's something I'd like you to see before you go back. He said, there's a group here called the Virginia Organization Society. It's a black people who've organized themselves to study their problems. He said, we are very proud of what they're doing. They've got communities organized, they look at their health problems, their work problems, labor problems, etc. And that working together in committees of seven is something which is very useful. Why don't you see if you cannot do the same thing in Africa? So the main thing I took back out of this missionary trip that I had around was when I went back home and I was studying at Fretifunk, Frank Anthony and Doyle Sumter, who had also studied in America, I said to them, you know, I brought something which I think we should consider. Let's do what our brothers in Virginia are doing. Let's see if we cannot form something like that. They said, okay, tell us something more. And I told them, and he said, okay, we'll call it the Sierra Leone Organization Society, named after the Virginia Organization Society. And pretty soon it became SOS, because it's a Sierra Leone Organization Society, and said, this is a message for us. It was as members of SOS that Frank Anthony and Doyle Sumner and I would attend, not as members because we were not government people, we would attend the Protected Assembly meeting that was being held in Bo. And it was while we were meeting in Bo, under the wing of Amadou Wuri, who was the first black headmaster of Bo School, and Sir Milton Magai, who was the government doctor at Bo. Incidentally, as you know, in spite of the fact that he qualified in England, when he came to Sierra Leone as a doctor, he never was promoted to more than just medical officer. All the younger Creole fellows and others would be posted to Freetown. He never was assigned to Freetown one day, and he served all of country. So he kind of resonated to our little message, and he said, well, I'm a government doctor, I cannot help you very much, except if you want to meet in my living room, if you're not meeting with Wuri because he's teaching, you can come. So we started meeting in his living room in the government hospital. So he heard about what we were doing. But as a government doctor, he could have nothing political. But then when I resigned and went to Nigeria, having started SOS, and I was president of SOS, and I was in Nigeria, the fellows said to me, well, we've got to appoint somebody in your place. So Milton Magai resigned at the same time, and so he became president of SOS in my absence. So it was while I was in Nigeria that these developments took place, which you know about. I will not go into that because it's not my business. He said to me, look, Karefa, you are the one who started this business. Now the British have said we have now reached the place where instead of just being nominated, we would have some people get an election and come to Parliament. It was not Parliament, it was the Legislative Council. He said, you come back here, you started this business, so you better come back from Nigeria. So again, I resigned from my medical school appointment there and I came back to Nigeria. And he said, of course, you know, you've come back now, but things are different. You cannot join us here until you get elected to Parliament. He said, I know you have no problem, so just go and get elected and come and join us. Fortunately, it was election time and I went to my people up in the north because my father had been transferred from Rotifunk, where he was pastor, to Yonibana. And I went there and I talked, the paramount chiefs were all his friends. In fact, one of them, Baikur, who was up the next level. You probably saw some, you've seen pictures of him. He always wore a red gown.
Yes.
And he was the only really literate chief who was in Legislative Council. And he happened to be a cousin of my father, Baikur. So, He sponsored me because his chiefdom was part of Tonkolili. It was in Mabang, which was the next stop after Yonibana on the Makeni chain. So he said, you have no problem. I just took my brother chiefs and tell them that you've got somebody to go to Parliament. So I went unopposed. I mean, when the time came for nomination, nobody else was put up to nominate. That's how I became elected to Parliament three different times with no opposition, because the people said, well, who else can we send but this young man who's come, he's a doctor, he's everything, and he can speak for us. So I accepted his invitation. But the interesting thing which you must know about if you're getting to understand is, the first thing he said to me after I got elected, he said, you know, I want you to do something for me. He said, I have the two of my leaders working with me, is Albert Magai, my younger brother, and Shaka Stevens, who came for us from the labor business, Madame Power Mines, etc., and Mustafa, who was a Creole, a Muslim from here. And I'm not satisfied with what they're doing. You, when you get elected, I'll tell you what I want you to do. So after, as soon as I got elected, he said, I want you to take Shaka Stevens' portfolio. Fortunately for me, Shaka Stevens did not win election that year. So without competing with him at all, I was elected in another part, and he was not in parliament. Shaka Stevens, in Legislative Council, Sir Milton said, you take his portfolio.
It was Mines, Lands and Labour.
Mm-hmm.
Mines, Lands and Labour.
Lands, Mines and Labour. But it was the Mines party was worried about.
Uh-huh.
He said, the reason is this. I sent these three people to London to negotiate the agreement with the Sierra Leone SLST, which was the company which was doing the Sierra Leone Selection Trust. And they came back with an agreement which I did not agree with. But they said this was the best they could do. But later on I heard that when they were in London, they were feasted by the people there and they were sent to Paris on vacation, etc. And they came back and I don't like what they did. They said, so I'm not pleased. So I want you to see what you can do. He said, but since when you came, I made you to go and visit Shaka Stevens in his office and you came back and told me what you saw. I want you to correct that. And what I told him was, when I went there, people were out. Being an Albert Academy old boy like myself, he welcomed me. But so we were chatting and not one after the other, people would knock at the door and say, "Pa, we don't can see you." And he'd say, "Oh no, come." He would come and bring a little suitcase and put it on his desk.
Mm-hmm.
And some people say, "You know what's in there, that suitcase then? I'm going to can't give him that bride in the dream." So I want to make you change all of that. So that was my assignment, was to change what Shaka Stevens had started doing in the thing. So from there on, you know, we came later on. Then the next year afterwards, it was only, the second year after I was elected, he said, now the British said we can begin to do what Ghana and Nigeria have done, come and talk about your future. So I want you to lead the delegation to London. I will not go, you take them, you know more about this thing than I do. So I took them again, unfortunately also, Albert Magai and not Shaka Stevens this time, the next time Shaka, Albert Magai and Mustafa were in the delegation and we went there. And we got on very well. The British, Sir Douglas Home was the foreign minister at the time. He said, look, you people have come to, you know what, we just want to make sure that you really understand what it's all about. And, you know, Ghana is going to be independent. Why don't you just understand it? Then, unfortunately for me, the Governor General, who was Maurice Dorman, received reports from Colonial Office that we had done so well that we were ready to fix a date for independence at once. This, he sent back a prompt report because he went and told lies to Sir Milton.
Uh-huh.
He said, you sent Karefa and the others to go. They're now talking about independence. Then he sent back a message. I've talked to the Prime Minister and he says he did not ask them to talk about independence. So they are going beyond us. So Sir Dr. Sim said, you see, it's not my fault. We were ready. Ghana would become independent. You can become independent the next year. But your people say you're not ready. So go back and tell Milton Magai, who was not a knight then, that you've come, you've made everything. If you come back next year, we can go ahead. You can go ahead now. So I went back with that anger in my mind that some Maurice Dorman had created this stomach. That's why we came back so many years behind.
Why did Dorman do that?
Oh, you know what, he wanted to stay. The longer he stayed, the more he got in the ranks of the colonial office. So that's how it was.
Okay, we still have 20 minutes on here.
Yeah.
Now this group, the group that you formed with Dr. Magai, that became the SLPP.
Yeah, what happened was it did not become SLPP at the beginning. It remained